Sharon Lechter is dedicated to sharing relevant and actionable steps to help you build a strong and sustainable financial foundation for your family. As co-author of Think and Grow Rich, 3 Feet from Gold, and Rich Dad, Poor Dad, and founder of Pay Your Family First, Sharon's messages have helped people around the globe take control of their financial lives. Please enjoy Sharon's It's Your Turn to Thrive, an audio series created just for you. In this audio, Sharon is joined by her son and business partner, Philip Lechter. Sharon and Philip discuss the important issues, both financial and emotional, that arise in family businesses. Please enjoy Blood and Money, the Family Business.
Hello, this is Sharon Lechter. Welcome back to It's Your Turn to Thrive. The title of this CD is Blood and Money, the Family Business. I'm really honored to have my son, Philip, as part of my company, president of Pay Your Family First, and my husband, Michael Lechter, is involved in many of my businesses. And we are very fortunate because we can work together, but it hasn't always been easy, and it's not always easy every day, because when you mix family issues, emotional issues, with money issues, whether it's a time of success or a time of reset, those things kind of get intermingled. That's why I titled this Blood and Money. But I will say there's nothing more rewarding than being able to celebrate together a success and really be able to see your children grow into incredible adults. And I'm very, very proud of Philip. And Philip is here to talk with us today about our family business. Welcome, Phil.
Thank you for having me again. I love this topic. It's so interesting because when being out in public and out on the road and speaking and teaching and doing a lot of those things that we do, oftentimes, you know, we get one of two comments. We get either the pat on the back that says, that's wonderful that you and your mom can work together. Or we get the, how in the world do you and your mom work together? You know, and it's so interesting because, you know, over the years, obviously, well, the last 10 years, we've been, you know, working together in all sorts of different capacities. You know, it really has been a true blessing, and I'm so thankful for that opportunity and to be part of this. And it would be great to just kind of walk through, and I think we'll share some of the insights that we have as to how we've been able to overcome some of our challenges, how we've been able to manage that relationship between mom and son. But even more so, I mean, this is, you know, no matter how you slice and dice it, who you work with tends to be who you spend the most time with. You know, and in most cases, I realize, you know, some people may think a little differently, but if you really, really break it down, where do we spend most of our energy? Most of our energy is typically spent in an office space or at work or doing the things that we do to make money. Of course, most of us would like that to be a little bit different, but the reality is what it is. And so no matter how you slice and dice it, who you work with typically does become your family in some shape or form. We just happen to have it taken to that one, you know, to that real step where it really is the family business. But hopefully what we talk about over the next few minutes, you'll be able to relate not just to in your personal family business, but also in your business in general and how you relate to people, how you're able to work together effectively when you're able to and work together in a way that moves the ball and creates a success.
Well, there's an element that I'd like to highlight here, because even if you don't have an actual business that you involve your children in, your financial life is a business. Mm. Your personal financial statement, how you're dealing with your everyday financial issues, is a business. Whether we like it or not, we're either succeeding or not. When you have a success in your personal life in the financial arena, your children are part of that success. And when you have a failure or a setback, they're right there with you. So it's very important, and we really want to encourage families to start talking about money. But let's talk about it from a business perspective. When Philip and I started working together, he was actually hired by my partner, because at the time I was a partner in a business, and I felt that it was important that if my son wanted to join the team, that it would be my partner that would acknowledge that and ask him to come on board. And that's exactly what happened. And I was thrilled. And we've been working together ever since. We now co-own a company, Pay Your Family First, and Philip serves as the president of that company. But when we started, even when we started the new company, we sat down and we said, okay, what are the rules? And those rules can change over time, but it was important to have an outline. A game has its rules. In the family business, is the same thing. You need to have rules. And our number one rule is family comes first.
That's right.
And it was very important that we recognize, because we take vacations together with the kids, and we wanted to make sure when, in fact, Phil's wife is very good at reminding us when we start talking about business and we're on family time. And so it's very important. We do break the rules occasionally, but to have that structure within your family is very important, particularly when we have three children and Philip is very involved in the business. Our daughter is slightly involved in the business and our youngest son is not. So when you're all together, you want to make sure you have a common ground.
Absolutely. It's so interesting because a great lesson I learned many, many years ago, and it was the story about hats. And the story title was called, What Hat Are You Wearing? And it was so interesting because the story, so it's this gentleman and he owns a business. And he had hired his nephew to come in and work for him. And the nephew, was really kind of just kind of a clown, right? He really just kind of did what he wanted to do, how he wanted to do it, wasn't really part of the team, didn't engage. And, you know, this boss pretty much had enough, the owner of this business. And so one morning, you know, the nephew came in late. And so, this gentleman brought him into his office and he put on his personal hat, said personal across the front of it. And he was asking, hey, how was your night last night? Did you have a great time? And, you know, and the nephew says, oh, it was great. We went to the bars. We did all these fun things, da 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 da. And he says, okay, great. Now I want to talk about the business. And he put on his owner's hat and he says, you're fired. And it was so interesting because what I really took from that story and that example was that you have to be able to separate it out. Oftentimes we mix our emotions all the way across the board, right? We have a personal issue, we bring it to business. We have a business issue, we bring it to personal. How many of you can relate to bringing work home with you even though you didn't have work to do? We're really talking about being able to separate that and making the conscious decision to separate the difference between business, personal, family, you know, health, all those things. You have to be able to separate and stop. And what it really comes down to, and we often use this term, is being present, right? Being present in what you're doing at that given moment. I can tell you, for a long time, I'd show up at a business meeting, I'd be thinking about what happened at home. Or I would, be thinking about the speeding ticket I just got on the way to that meeting because I was running late. Whatever that is for you, it's just being able to put that stuff aside and being present. And that was one of the things that we really clarified as part of the responsibilities inside of our organization, was that we could be present with what was happening in front of us at that moment, whether it was business or family. And it was such an important aspect for us to define. Because obviously, it's so easy to spend all of your time talking about business and not being able to shut that off.
One of the other issues that's very important and something that we're not always the best at, but it's something that we certainly try, and that is when you have an issue come up, deal with it right away. Mm-hmm. And deal with it face to face. When you're family, you can want to call real fast, you want to deal with something. Sometimes that's not the right medium. If you have an issue that could be an emotional trigger as it relates to business, you need to deal with that with your family member, actually with anybody. But when we talk about the family business, it's so much more important because you need to deal with the issue right away. If I have an issue with you, Phil, we get together, we talk about it.
Absolutely.
Same thing you with me. You don't want me talking to your wife about an issue that I'm having with you. That is not good for either family or business. And so it's very important so that we really define our space. We want to talk about business. We know we're not going to do it in the living room. We're going to do it in the office.
Right.
And the other little rule that you and I have always had is that because Phil's 6'6", and I make him sit down so I can yell at him when I'm a mom. But in our business relationship, he calls me Sharon because that is what feels comfortable when we're out in the world. But when we're at home, he calls me mom.
And it slips every once in a while. And of course, you know, I'll get the look here and there. But,
the evil eye.
Yeah, the evil eye. But it's so true. And you know, the other part that we also talked about as well is, and we established this, because, you know, we're so close-knit, and the rest of our family isn't involved in the day-to-day business, it was really important for us to control what we called the pillow talk. You know, the pillow talk is, you know, I'd be at home with my wife and she'd ask me how my day is, and we're, you know, at the end of the day, we're talking about that, and all I would say is the negative, right? Because we're venting. You know, this is our opportunity to vent. This is what went wrong today. This is what went wrong. And what you realize after time is that all, you know, for instance, all my wife would hear is how bad things were. Or she would hear how, you know, how Sharon did this, or, you know, Kevin did that, or whatever that is. And it was so important that we really established that we control the pillow talk. Because in a family business, the pillow talk is actually where the upsets happen. So think about it. I go home and we've had a, you know, we've had a great day, but there was one conversation that Sharon and I had that didn't go the way we wanted it to go. And so I'm at home and I'm venting to my wife saying, you know, we had this conversation and I'm upset or whatever's going on with my emotional state on this. And so all she thinks about for my day was that one example. And so now she carries that. Now next time she sees Sharon, she's carrying that. And so, you know, she may confront her about it or who knows. And in the end, it was no big deal, right? So pillow talk is such an important thing that we have to manage in this relationship, particularly because we are so close-knit. There are these other hats that we're wearing. You know, we're business people. We're family people. You know, we're doing all those things. It's really important to control, you know, in an office, we call it the water cooler, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, it's an issue of respect. You need to respect each other, and you also need to respect each other's strengths and weaknesses.
Yes.
And sometimes, particularly when you're starting a new business and everybody's wearing lots of hats, let's go back to your hat reference, sometimes somebody using a hat, my technology hat is not very strong. So you don't want me doing something on the website. So we really need to understand where the strengths are and rely on the individual with the right strength to do a task at hand.
Well, and that's actually such an important step, and this really dives down into the family pieces, is that, you know, as both parents and as kids, and I can play both hats. I have a, you know, 14-year-old and a 3-year-old at home, as well as being a son. It's so, in a family environment, we often have expectations and or we, you know, we think we know who this person is, right? You know, we think we know from my growing up, I think I knew who you were. But, you know, oftentimes that wasn't always the case. You know, I had a certain perception or a reality that was, you know, one way, you know, growing up. But then, you know, but in a business structure, that didn't relate. And so it's really important to that, to get to know, you know, the individuals, to get to know your mom for who she is in that environment versus what you thought of her, you know, when she was taking away your car keys and she wouldn't let you go see your girlfriend as a teenager, right?
Well, I prefer the topic of when my 3-year-old was at home and saw me on TV and started jumping up and down.
That's
a much,
right.
much nicer example.
Absolutely right.
Wanting to know why I was in the TV instead of there reading to him. So, there is nothing better than having your family participate in business with you, but there's also nothing worse when it goes bad.
Mm-hmm.
And so you really need to try and navigate the family business in as structured a way as possible. And some of the times you might want to think about having a family friend who can serve as a mediator if it gets to that point. But it's very important to really structure the relationship so that everyone is in agreement as how you're going to deal with a disagreement and how you're going to resolve the disagreement. Sometimes the resolution is you disagree.
Yes.
And you both accept the fact that you disagree and you move forward. In our business that we have, Pay Your Family First now, we operate as a team environment and everyone has an input and a say. And so it's very important that at some point there needs to be a final decision made and we all need to agree to live with that decision. And that's something that, again, is called mutual respect.
Absolutely. You know, it's okay to have heated dialogue. It's okay to have that disagreement or to have a different set of opinions, because, look, we all have opinions.
So I really encourage you to involve your kids, even if you are an employee and you don't have a business on the side. Let your children know what you're doing, because educating them early about how a business operates is a gift of a lifetime, because they're going to learn about money by how it's created, because money is created through businesses. And it's a great opportunity to educate your children early. And certainly today, with the increased number of part-time businesses that are being started, people that are losing their jobs or are afraid of losing their jobs are now starting small businesses at a record rate. So it's a wonderful opportunity to involve your children. And in fact, there are certain tax breaks related to that that we're going to talk about on another CD. But it's so important, because it's a great opportunity to build that family business. And then I want to talk a little bit more about the dynasty. You hear over and over and over again the statistics of the entrepreneur becomes a millionaire, makes lots and lots of money, and then their kids spend it all, waste it, and the third generation doesn't have it. And I want to break that cycle. And that is the whole reason we created Pay Your Family First. We want to break the cycle of that in-between instant gratification, I expect it without having to earn it, and I want to do what I want when I want, because it's that entitlement mentality. I often say that we've blown right through the entitlement mentality and gone into a new age of expectation. And it's my generation that has created that, because we were basically, most of us were self-made. And we were successful. We made a lot of money. We wanted to make sure our children had everything in the world we didn't have. And in doing that, they didn't experience that same ability to make it on their own.
Mm.
And that's even more important in a family business, because you need to allow your kids to make mistakes. Even if they're grown-up kids, you need to allow them to make mistakes. And I know in our relationship, Phil and I are partners in some real estate. We're also partners in Pay Your Family First. But there was a time when Philip started his own company, his wife started a company, and he started a company. And we had meetings, and they would ask for my counsel, and I would give it. And sometimes they would follow it, and sometimes they wouldn't. And yet, at the same time, I respected their ability to make that decision, and we were able to laugh about it later. And as you know, we talk about businesses sometimes are the best way to get your MBA, Master's in Business Awareness, not just a degree. So it's really important that we allow our kids to make the decisions that are right for them at that time, sometimes even when we know they may not end up the way they hope them to. And that's really one of the most difficult things a parent can do. But sometimes when they're adults, you need to allow them to do it, because sometimes you aren't the one that's right. Maybe they are going to create a hugely successful business. So allow your kids to make those decisions, but keep the energy and the support structure there. Because at the end of the day, your family is always going to be your family. And I know that I have my passion about business as a result of my living with my dad and my mom. They were both entrepreneurs. And I saw they worked hard. My dad worked till the day he passed away. And my mom still, you know, is a very important that lifestyle is what they passed on to me, working hard. And I hope that that same lifestyle is passed on to my children and to their children. Because we know in today's environment, a tremendous amount of government debt, a tremendous amount of household debt is going to be saddling our children. So we need to give them those tools of how to start businesses, how to build their wealth, and how to create their own dynasty for their children.
I can't agree with you anymore. And here's the thing, that one of the things though, that I've really learned recently being in the dad role, because obviously I've learned so much through being in the son role, but being in the dad role, I realized that there isn't enough communication that I can have with my kids about what I do. You know, so often, you know, it's so funny, my 3.5-year-old, I'll come home and he goes, "Hey, Dad, how was your meetings?" Right? Because he thinks that's all I do all day is meetings. And it was actually through my wife. I mean, she's a kindergarten teacher, so she deals with young kids all the time. And she goes, "You know, tell them about them." And all of a sudden, he started asking me these random questions, just like, "Well, how do they build the electronic games? How do they, you know, do this?" And all of a sudden, we had a half an hour dialogue with my 3.5-year-old about what I do and what we're doing in our business and how I teach and all those different things. And, you know, you'd be amazed at what they really do understand. And I would just really offer up this idea that at every age, really sharing with them what you do, helping them understand, because it's so easy to just say, "Oh, yeah, great day." I remember, you know, and by the way, our kids do that with us all the time. "How was school?" "Boring." Right? You know, my 14-year-old, how was school? "Boring." You know, and it's just like, okay, well, what did you do? "Nothing." You know, I mean, and oftentimes we as parents do the exact same thing. And so I really encourage you to have real open dialogue about it, about what's working, what's not. And I agree completely. Oftentimes the best action by a parent is no action at all. And allowing them to, you know, to get the learning lesson, because so often we learn more from, you know, when we stub our toe than if we never kick the couch in the first place.
Well, it's also very important, and I really encourage you to talk to your kids about our business and to the listeners about your businesses, because our kids can be very creative. They're coming at it from a very innocent, a very whiteboard, blank sheet of paper perspective. And sometimes we live so much in our business that we can't look at it from a neutral position. And our kids can be exceptionally creative. And we just in the last few weeks have met a young man that's a teenager. He's 17 and a tremendous entrepreneur, and we're just really thrilled with hearing his input and his ideas as to how we can grow and build our business, because that's the age group we want to involve and we want to ignite their entrepreneurial spirit. Mm-hmm. So we love that kind of feedback. We just played the game Thrive Time for Teens with a group of girls at a girls' school, and unbelievable. At the beginning, the headmaster, principal, was saying, "I just want to warn you, these girls don't ever get engaged. You know, they're really kind of, they don't like to learn." And within 30 minutes, these girls were engaged and laughing, and that principal, her mouth was on the floor. She said, "I've never seen this kind of interaction." And that's because it's important to create those tools that are engaging and fun and interactive and experiential and allow them to experience. I often say young people want to learn. They just don't want to be taught.
Absolutely.
So create and ignite that learning environment in your own family and for your young people. On a more structured note, it's very important when you have a family business to build in the ability for succession. And when you have multiple children, when you have blended families, it's ever so much more important. We talk about that from just a personal perspective on your estate planning, your family estate planning, but it's even more so important in a business, because your business, for instance, in my business with Philip, we also have two other partners who are not blood-related family, even though they are like family to us. It's important to establish how that business should happen something to me, how that business is going to go on, and how it's going to be run. And so as you look at your family, think about, you may have a child who is an overachiever, and you may have another one who's an underachiever. And so you may want to build in certain specific requirements on how those businesses are going to continue operating, mm-hmm. or how the shares in that business that I own are going to be distributed among children. And it's even more important in a family-owned business that you have a buy-sell type arrangement and that you have a plan for how that business is going to continue on should something happen to one of the executives.
Absolutely. One of the worst things that can happen is for when there is a medical issue or there is a change of leadership in some cases, for there to be a void as to who's going to do what. That's typically where you find your biggest amount of drama, your biggest upset, and typically, you know, typically your biggest lawsuits. Yeah, and it's really unfortunate. But, you know, one of the things that we've really learned to do is we've really learned, you know, how to just deal with the things ahead of time, how to put a plan into place, how to put aside, you know, and have the tough conversations, because without that, we would not be able to function together effectively or successfully.
And I really also recognize and acknowledge sometimes you look at your kids like they're still kids. And so as parents and as the older one in the business, sometimes you have to take a step back and really marvel at the incredible young person that's standing in front of you who's an adult, much as I am today. I'm very pleased with Philip's participation in the company and certainly his insights as we're doing this CD series together. But I think it's really also... it's a real testament to your father. As a parent, it's really important to know when to shift the role of a parent, which is a teacher, to that of a mentor. And it's a real fine line, because sometimes you want to give advice even when it's not asked for. And it's important to understand when to make that shift. And I'm very proud of Philip and the young man that he's become, and very, very excited about the future. And I can tell you, I love being a grandma. But the bottom line is we are family first, and we've created this business together. We own real estate together. And there's nothing more rewarding than working with your family. And I implore all of you, I think you should think about how to incorporate your family into your business, how to include your family in your personal finances, and how to make plans to grow together. Because blood and money mix very well in the family business when you put the right foundation, the right formula, and the right respect into the mix. Thank you, Phil.
Thank you.
You have been listening to Sharon Lechter, the world's most passionate financial literacy advocate. To learn more about Sharon, visit www.itsyourturntothrive.com and see her exceptional content. To book Sharon for upcoming live events or coaching, call 480-607-1940.